Thanks for staying with us. Right now, we are talking about assessing women's participation in politics and the proposed special National Assembly seats for women and people living with disabilities. The proposed bill adds 6 seats to Nigeria's House of Representatives, allocating 1 seat per geographical or geopolitical zone for women and persons with disabilities, PWDs. Special representatives will be elected via an electoral college of grassroots interest groups promoting inclusivity and regional balance. The amendment seeks to address historical underrepresentation and create a more equitable legislative framework for marginalized groups. Passing the bill requires a 2/3 majority in both chambers of the National Assembly and state legislature ratification. We're looking primarily at women participation in politics and what climate the political space is giving to women. Can they flourish or it will still be suppressing them? Joining us to discuss this is Princess Abiodun Oyefusi, former Labour Party Deputy Governorship candidate in Lagos State. Good morning and welcome to the program, Princess.
Good morning. Nice, it's an honor to be here. Good morning, Lagos, and good morning, Nigeria.
Okay, just for the benefit of those who may not know Princess so well, Princess is not just a name, it's a title, because she's the daughter of the late Anyogberun of Ikorodu, and she holds a law degree from the prestigious Aberdeen Law School, MBA from University of Hull, and currently an associate of the Chartered Institute of Governance, UK and Ireland, and a project management practitioner. She's a renowned politician, humanitarian, and women advocate at the forefront of the actualization of the equality for women and women agenda. Like I said earlier, she was a governorship deputy governorship candidate for Lagos State Labour Party 2019, PDP Lagos East senatorial candidate. She is current chairperson Soul Lifters Foundation, the international NGO behind known community outreaches in Lagos State, which are community medics providing monthly medical care, eye care, and mental health outreaches in various communities throughout the 20 local governments of Lagos State, and Community Food Bank, providing monthly food banks for the homeless, elderly, single parents, orphans, and the most vulnerable people within. You know why I had to give these credentials of yours? You contested as a deputy governor, which means you were going to bring your wealth of experience and the kind of things you do to bear in Lagos State. Yet, you did not sail through. So, one would be wondering, for someone who is doing all this, is it a matter of credentials, or is it a matter of society, or is it a matter of what? Let's just start with your experience. Your experience when you contested as deputy governor, even from the time you contested as in your senatorial district and all that. What has been your experience like, specifically, as it relates to your being a woman?
My experience in politics in Nigeria, first of all, you have to know the Nigerian politics. It's not played the normal political way that is played in Europe, that is played in America. It's a different atmosphere, it's a different culture. And that Nigerian democratic process has been adapted to that culture. You're looking in the political arena, you have the violence, you have the money, you have the also the party issues, you have the female issue, the female cultural issue. So there are a lot of issues that affect women in Nigerian politics. And when you strip that down, you now realize that what we have on the table, what we're facing, is very similar to what these women face in Europe and what the blacks face in America. Because we need that legislation. We need that support, that balance, that law behind us to give us that footing into that political arena. It's a men's game in Nigeria. It's a men's culture game. Everything. If you look at what has been happening in Nigeria since 1960, when we got the independence, and since 1999, when we introduced the proper democracy, you will see that this trend is against women. So my experience is that you have, having run these two races, it's like you have to prove that you can do this more than the men have to do to prove. You have to prove you have better, you know what you're doing. You also have to appeal to the grassroots. So because it's a cross-section dynamics, there is the leadership structure of all the parties, of all how the system works. Then you have the grassroots, which you have to appeal, you have to speak to them, you have to speak their language, you have to know how each one of those communities
by their
works.
Language, what yeah. do you mean? I wouldn't let that go. By their language, what do you mean?
Oh, yeah.
Because it's not a matter, when you were mentioning some of these things, competence was at the background. You were talking about party structures, we're talking about financial muscle, you were talking about so many other things, but it wasn't so much about what the capacity you have upstairs and all that. So now you're just mentioning language. What is this language that the people need to hear?
You are competent. You see, Nigeria, let's not kid ourselves. You have different classes in Nigeria. You have the people, the very educated, you have the less educated, you have our mothers, who are the market women, who are the, you have the local traders, you have all sorts of groups. If you don't speak, if you cannot relate to the various groups within that political structure, your education, your intellectual
But you are involved in the grassroots with NGOs, with outreach
exactly.
that you've been doing and all that. Exactly. One cannot say it's because you couldn't speak to them.
For me, it's not that we didn't win the election. It's wanting to win the election. It's always wanting to be declared winner.
Okay,
that's another structure.
Yes.
You see, with Nigeria, we have a lot of issues. Our institutions needs to be restructured so that good governance can come through, so that people's vote can count, so that the integrity and the intellectual in each of these institutions that was supposed to build a nation can make us function seamlessly, can make us function effectively, then what you're saying will not come into place. But if you look, for example, look at NAS. Look at, come on, let's look at the people there. Our NAS is more or less become a construction industry. NAS is supposed to make the laws of the countries. Have the people in there. The same thing for the assembly. So it's first of all, you have to know the political game. If you cannot play the political game, no matter how intellectual you are, you can't win.
So, but okay, now this brings us to the next aspect of this discussion. Women have been talking about getting this political climate in such a way that the women can function really well. Are you comfortable with these handouts that they've been talking about? For instance, the National Assembly is thinking about giving seats, six seats, and they are putting women and the people living with disabilities on the same pedestal and saying that they are going to give six seats for every geopolitical zone to produce. Is that enough to make the women grow to the political height that they should grow to?
First of all, I want to
support
I want to thank the Deputy Speaker for putting the bill forward. But we don't need to reinvent the wheel. We do not need to reinvent the wheel. There is already a UN convention treaty that was signed by Nigeria that gives women 35% proportional representation at all level, 35% in every area of life. Nigeria is signed that treaty. Nigeria signed that agreement. And we were supposed to bring that agreement back to Nigeria and implement it into our local domestic laws. But the federal government never implemented it into law. Only a few states, like Kaduna, like Ogun State, that signed it into law. So when the NAS is saying to us, they want to give us special seat. What is a special seat? You have an agreement. You don't need that. If you really want to help women, implement that 35%. So if you take that 35%, we have 107 in Senate. If 35% of that seat belongs to women, how many women is that? How many women will be in Senate by now? Now we have four. There is no level playing field in Nigerian politics. We need the law. We need affirmative action to push women, to push people with disability forward into position, into equality. So if you give us that 35% in Senate, 107, 35% of 107 is roughly about 36, 37, am I right? If go to the House of Representatives, there's 340 something. And you want 35% of that. That's over 100. So why are you trying to give me one seat when I already have the law that gives me women balance?
Okay, in fairness, and being practical enough.
We just need them to sign that law. Okay. We need not to sign that law.
Whether the law is signed or not, how workable will that be? Because every party wants to front a candidate that can win. And do you think that if the parties just say, okay, because they have said the law should be like this, okay, let's give 35% of these women the opportunity to go and contest, when the women have not psychologically, financially, or any...
I'm just saying. That is not right. They are very high quality, highly educated. Far more better than men.
I know.
Leadership.
I know. What I'm saying is, for instance, in the banking sector, they didn't need affirmative action for the women to hijack all the positions, MDs everywhere in the financial sector. They didn't do that because that playing field was level enough. Now, I'm concerned about the fact that women are not talking much about making this playing field as level as it should be, but they're talking about how, because of the law, like you just said, they should be handed over 35%.
No, it's not a case of handed over 35%. And what, yes, in the private sector, you know...
They said that they are voted. Everybody is voted in. What if you're given the ticket and you're not voted in? Would you still quarrel about 35%?
One thing that I'm sure you've heard something called equal opportunity policies. That has been what has been applied in the private sector, in the banking industries that you're talking about. It's called equal opportunity. They have taken that policy from the from UK, from US, from the world, modern world, and bring it into the private sector. And that has given a platform for everybody to be assessed on equality. There's something called guaranteed interview for people with disability. If they meet the minimum requirement for every job, once they meet that minimum requirement, they are given the opportunity. They will be considered first because of their ability. That's how you create equality in an environment, in a society, in an environment. That's where equality starts from. But we are not saying give us 35% and we just throw anybody at you. Women has been contesting for a very long time in Nigeria. They are very qualified, very educated women. We need that enabling environment.
I agree about the intelligence and the competence. I agree totally because everybody knows that, you know, women are, there are a lot of women. Let's just leave it that way. But, you know, if you're talking about an elective position, some political parties right now give their nomination forms and whatever forms it is that you guys buy, because I'm not a politician, for free to women. Some give at half the price that they give to men to women. So what is missing that can make women stronger, that can make women, that can encourage women more to fight this fight? Because if you leave it like it's a man's fight, anything that comes to us is because some convention somewhere has said that it should come to us. As a person, I'm finding it very difficult to marry these two. So what else should political parties, for instance, do to make sure women are encouraged to go more into politics and fight that fight?
You see, because you have to look at our culture. You have to look at our religion. You have to look at, it's very, very different from the European world. We have a culture that says, for example, religion that says some, you educate the boys before the girls. You girls stay at home, they marry young, all sort of things. The women look after the children in the home. Some of these cultures are still there, although we're breaking down the barriers. But that's the same thing.
But there are some cultures that they train only women anyway, even in Nigeria, because the boys will now go to be apprentice and then be businessmen.
They train the women to be the homekeeper.
They train the women
to be the homekeeper.
But that's a matter for another day.
No, seriously, because of where we find ourselves, we need that law. That law is not just in Nigeria. It's applicable across Africa. And it's been implemented across Africa. Rwanda is doing very well. Zimbabwe is doing very well. All of these countries are doing very well in implementing that law. When you create a law that gives equal opportunity for people, women, children, women with disability to be part of society, then you have give them the first base to grow on. That's what women need in politics, because politics, Nigerian politics, is about money. It's a very expensive. If you want to give a nomination form, there is two forms. And when you go to contest primary, they're not giving the two for free. You pay for one, they give you one for free. There is still this funds that you need to raise in terms of contesting for primaries, your delegates, your campaign material. No party is giving you that for free. You come with it to the party to contest. Then you sell your ability. You sell your.
What's the role of the party if they don't support the candidates to do all those things? Because I thought when you get a nomination, everybody lines behind you and supports you and sponsors you and does everything for you.
From the funds that they raised, from the
sale of forms.
Sale of forms. They do provide a little support, but it is down to you as a candidate to go out there and raise the funds. And you are going into a men's club. Like, let's be honest, it's a men's club. Where the men's, you know your language now, when you speak your language, you get...
I don't know.
You have to come and appeal for funds in the same club that is been funding men since the foundation of the heart. Is there, you have to come back.
But is this not wrong? Because aside from whether there was a law or not, why should parties not be the ones to raise the funds for their candidates? It doesn't make sense to me. Because it's only in doing that everybody would know that, okay, once I can struggle and get to this point, every other thing will be added to me by the party. It doesn't make sense to me that you have to raise your funds, you have to do your flyers, you have to
speak a
particular language.
Even in the U.S., you have to raise your funds. See how many funds Donald Trump, Kamala Harris, they have to raise their funds. Go to GoFundMe. Go to the public. Donation, you have to go raise your funds. The parties don't have that pot. They don't have that funding to fund every single candidate. It will be. But they have the ability to create a level playing field. You do not set up a committee. You don't set up a committee of 12 people, then put one woman there. That's not equal opportunity.
I see that. And yeah. Then ministerial appointments.
Exactly. All the both selective
right
and
now,
elective.
It's amazing that our time is up. But I'd like you to talk specifically, not just to the men and everybody who is not making, but talk to the women as well. Because sometimes, some people even say the problem of the women in politics is women themselves. So talk to the women as someone who has had that experience so that we wrap up.
Okay. All right. Women in politics, our women leaders that are in the Senate, that are in the Assembly, that are in the House, I'm appealing to you now. You are the leaders. You are the front of these women. You need to rise up and support women. And it is high time that women support women, wherever you find them, contesting in any position, for any position from the local government, councillors right up to the presidency. Women, we constitute 55% of population of Nigeria. We are the one that brings the men into power. It's time we start bringing the women into power so they can create policies. They can create our environment that will empower the girl child, that will bring policies that will develop women, that will support the development of market women, women education, women marriage, domestic violence, child abuse, all of that. It's only women that can bring those policies, that can enable that policies to be implemented across the board. So it's time to start supporting women into leadership.
WSW, Women Supporting Women. It's something that we should do. Okay, we'd like to thank you, Princess, for coming on the show. It's been a pleasure having you. We wish that we had more time, but this is where we'd have to wrap up. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure being here. Yeah. And nice to meet you.
We've been talking with Princess Abiodun Oyefusi, former Labour Party Deputy Governorship candidate here in Lagos State. We're looking at women participation in politics, and the bottom line is, there should be a more level playing field for women to flourish in the political space. But that's how we wrap it up on the show this morning. We'd like to thank you for being a part of it. Let's do it again tomorrow, same time. My name is Nyamgul Agaji. Bye for now.